the tracks. And prior to this, obviously, Judas has already been to the garden. The betrayal has already taken place. And so these two characters are really kind of in tandem together between Peter and Judas. And these two ones of this train starts to go. We get the picture of Judas who betrays Jesus with a kiss. We get Peter on the bottom right-hand or left-hand side who, those stupid chickens are always in these pictures, aren't they, right? Now, Peter, I wonder if Peter hated chickens after that, roosters in particular. But you see, he's given up on Jesus who is in the background. And these sort of things. And we get this picture in particularly in Matthew 27. I just want to begin to read it beginning at verse 3. Matthew 27, beginning at verse 3. It says, "Then when Judas, his betrayer," talking about Jesus, "saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and to the elders, saying, 'I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.' They said, 'Well, what is that to us? See to it yourself.' And throwing down the pieces of silver into the temple, he," Judas, "departed, and he went and he hanged himself." And the story goes on that the chief priests and the religious leaders, they don't know what to do with this money because it's blood money. It's been paid a price to condemn Jesus. And so they go and buy this field, apparently the field where Judas hung himself. This was his remorse to things. See, there's three things that kind of happened with Judas, and we're going to kind of go through these in our time here this morning. But Judas, kind of like Peter, they kind of offset one another. Peter and Judas both doubt God's plan. Peter, he says, "No, Jesus, you don't have to go and suffer. You don't have to go to the religious authorities. You don't have to do these things." Judas doubts God's plan because he wants to speed things up. He sees Jesus as this military leader, as a political figure. He may be sort of a Messiah figure, but Judas wants to speed things up. He's not trusting in God's plan. He's got doubts about God's plan. And so he wants to speed it up and kind of make Jesus rise to the forefront. But then he begins to realize that Jesus is now condemned. Jesus is not rising up as this great political leader, this great military leader. And all of a sudden, there's this remorse that sets in. And he feels bad, and he tries to undo what he's already done, and he tries to make amends. But it's just this remorse thing. He's gotten caught. But Peter, on the other hand, there's a big difference. Because Peter, when he realizes what he has done in his denial of Christ, he's not just remorseful. He's repentant. He turns things around, right? We get this beautiful picture of reconciliation. We get this beautiful picture that yet Jesus may still take me in. He may still forgive me. So Peter and Judas both, they doubted God's plans. They doubted God's providence, that God's going to work these things out, that God will take care of us, that God is still in this. But Judas forgot the promises. This is where it changed for Judas. And this is where we get the consequences of Judas, right? He figures it's all undone. There's no more promises. I'm beyond help. I'm beyond anything that God can do for me now. And he gives up. And he ends up taking his own life. But Peter doesn't forget the promises. Peter still is hanging on that there's still hope. Jesus, he hung out with Jesus enough to know that there's still hope, that there was still forgiveness, that there was still love, there was still kindness that was going out there. And so for Peter and for Judas, they were running on the track of this discipling life, and then it started to get rocky. For Judas, the train car fell off. For Peter, he was kind of rocky. He was starting to teeter a little bit, but he stayed on. He stayed on because he believed in the promises of God. And that was the big difference for Peter over top of Judas. This morning we're going to be going back to our Pilgrim's Progress. We've been going through this. It's been a bit of a long series, I know. I hope you've kind of enjoyed it. I hope you've picked up some practical things on it. It's been a while since we've been at it. We've only got two more sermons to go through on this. Okay, so we're on the home stretch. Don't give up on me now. Okay, Christian's heading for the celestial city. Okay, I don't want to spoil the ending, but he makes it. Okay, and so it's going to be great. But the story this morning really kind of parallels this idea, the stories of between Peter and Judas. So we've got the story of Christian and Hopeful, and they're going along the path. There's this wonderful path that they're on, right? This narrow road that they're on, and it actually starts off quite well. Starts off quite well. They actually get to a place where Bunyan writes, John Bunyan, he writes that they're enjoying the river of life. There's a stream that is there. It's a beautiful area. They're drinking from the stream. They're being refreshed. Everything's going great. There's fruit trees that are lining up this river, and they're eating of it, and they're just getting their fill, and everything's going really, really well. And so they head back out on their journey on this little narrow path, and the picture is painted that there's a fence along this path. And on the other side of this fence is this green meadow, very lush, very beautiful. But as they go along, this path starts to get rockier, starts to get, you know, heavy trotting. It's rocky. It's not very easy to go. And so Christian, he spies this meadow, and he's like, well, these are going in the same direction. They're paralleling one another. Why can't we just kind of hop the fence and follow in this meadow for a while? Because I'm sure, right? I'm sure they both go to the celestial city. But in fact, they don't. Christian and Hopeful, they hop the fence, and they start to go. And as anything, you know, everything looks nice and straight, but if you're just a little ways off, over the distance, it carries you off into a completely different direction. And that's what happens to Christian and Hopeful. Before they know it, this path is no longer leading to the celestial city. It is leading off into a territory that is claimed by Doubting Castle. Doubting Castle. In fact, this picture here, is not a picture of Doubting Castle. This is a picture of the Bedford Jail, where John Bunyan spent a dozen and more years there. This becomes a very dark story in Bunyan's life, in the life of Christian and in Hopeful, but it ends up on a good note. And so some have actually said maybe this story of this veering off was a story of Bunyan's life, right? He's sitting in a dungeon writing this story out. He's living this. This maybe were dark times for him. Maybe he started to have doubts of faith, doubts of things that God had promised him. Remember, he was in jail, imprisoned, for preaching the gospel. That was his only crime. He believed in the gospel of Jesus Christ. He believed it should be preached to all people. And that was the crime why he was in the dungeon. Maybe he was starting to have some doubts. I'm not quite sure. But Christian and Hopeful, they find themselves in the territory of Doubting Castle. They start to get worried. Christian in particular is quite worried. He's quite growing in fear because he's the one who's now led Hopeful astray. And so he's starting to get this idea of remorse that is happening. Not a real change in things, but he's starting to feel bad about stuff. Feeling bad that he's taken them off course. And so night falls. They both fall asleep. They don't know what to do. They don't know how to get back onto the path. And so they both fall asleep. And all of a sudden, the owner of the territory of Doubting Castle finds these two trespassers. And his name is Giant Despair. Giant Despair. He is the owner, the proprietor of Doubting Castle. And he founds these two ones trespassing upon his property. And he takes them both by the scruff of the necks, and he throws them into the dungeon of Doubting Castle, for being trespassers. And we're told that he beats them ferociously, is the words that John Bunyan used. He beats them ferociously until they're just hanging on, clinging on to life. As I said, it's one of those dark stories that are taking place within Christian, in the story of Hopeful. And Giant Despair promises that every day he's going to come back and he's just going to beat them more, constantly, consistently. That is that's their lot in life. And so Christian begins to grow in this idea of doubt, this idea of despair. And so one day Giant Despair comes back and he says, you know what? You can enjoy my beatings every day for the rest of your life, or you can end up taking your own life. Giant Despair, in fact, lays out a table with a noose, a knife, and some poison. And he says, I'm going to leave you be for the night. You guys can decide to take your own life, end this pain and suffering. But if you're still alive in the morning, I'm going to come back and I'm going to beat you some more. And so over that, there was a struggle. Christian was starting to dwell in doubts, dwell in despair, dwell into fear and depression. He wanted a quick end to the pain, and so he started to consider this idea of ending his own life, to taking it, because it just can't get any better. He's running his Christian life on tracks of despair and doubt. That's where he's running his train, and he doesn't know what to do. But Hopeful, true to his name, tries to encourage Christian. He tries to encourage, remind Christian of God's plans, of God's providence. He says, well, surely, Christian, other pilgrims have been on this path. Surely God has released them from this prison, from these dungeons. Surely God will help us as well. He also tries to remind Christian that God has helped them all along. He's provided for them all along in the valley of the shadow of death, in the valley of humiliation. He's helped them fight Apollyon, that great fearsome warrior. If God has helped us in the past, will he not help us presently, even in these times? That reminded me of the stories of David, right, when he rushes off to face the giant Goliath. And what does David do, right? He says, well, God has already been with me. He's helped me to fight lions and bears, oh my. When I was a shepherd, and God will do it again to fight this giant and to conquer him. And so Hopeful is doing his best to try to encourage Christian. And finally, they take to prayer. It's kind of sad, but that becomes their last resort. They begin to pray. They know next day that the giant despair is going to come back and either beat them senseless or maybe even possibly just kill them. Be done with it outright. And so finally, on the Saturday night, it says, Bunyan writes this. He says, they began to pray, and they continued in prayer till almost break of day. Now a little before it was day, good Christian, as one half amazed, broke out into this earnest speech. So this is Christian. He says, what a fool, he said. Here I lie in this foul-smelling dungeon when I may as well walk at liberty. I have a key in my pocket called promise that will, I am sure, open any lock in Doubting Castle. Then said Hopeful, that is good news, good brother. Pluck it out and let's give it a try. Finally, when they take their problems back to God. Remember, they've been doubting God's plan, God's providence, his care for them. And all of a sudden, once they start to pray, this idea of promises comes back, that God has promised to take care of them. God has promised that he has a plan. If they stick on this road, they stick on this path, even a promise of forgiveness, even a promise of reconciliation when they go off the path. It is when they begin to depend on God through prayer that they are reminded of promise, this key that Christian has. And all of a sudden, hope returns. It begins to vanquish and to conquer doubt and despairs, fears and anxieties. And so they pluck this key out and they try it in the dungeon door, and it doesn't work. I'm just kidding. It works. It works great. The door swings open. And they get into the next level of the chambers, and they try it in that door, and that flings wide open. And then they try it into the outer wall that leads to the green meadow where they've gone off stray, and they try that, and that flings open. And these guys run as fast as they can, trying to get back to that nice little path that was so rocky and so hard, but seems so good now. And they get back there, and they're so excited because they've claimed the promises of God. These promises of God have conquered their fears, their doubts, their despair, even in the midst of great tragic situations. And they don't just leave it at that. In fact, we are told that they put up a sign. They make a sign for all the pilgrims that will follow them, saying, what's over this fence? This is the territory of Doubting Castle, whose proprietor is Giant Despair. Stay away from there. And they don't just, you know, go off on their merry way. They warn others of how to stay away from doubt and despair, how to stay away from fears and anxieties. In fact, it says in the book, it says, many therefore that followed after read what was written and escaped the danger. They'd claim the promises of God. And they didn't just keep them to themselves. They told others. They put up this sign. They put up warnings of how we can escape. How we can escape fears. How we can escape doubts and despairs and all these wonderful things that we don't want. Sorry, I'm kind of behind in my pictures here. So it's these promises of God that we are to claim. A couple weeks back, actually probably almost a month back, I had this incredible dream. I don't know, how many are really big dreamers? I mean, it's just so vivid that you just wake up and it has to be real. Okay? Yeah, sometimes you're just like, whoa, was that real or not? And you kind of have to pinch yourself. But a month ago, I had this dream about losing my keys. It was just a bizarre dream. Never had anything like it before. It seemed so real. And it was so weird because I don't lose things. I'm really hard on myself when I lose things. I beat myself up and I'm just like, how could I be so silly? Because I'm one of those guys that said there's a place for everything and everything in its place. Right? Any one of those, you know, those OC people out there? Yeah, okay, good. And so I had this dream that I'd lost my keys, and I'm like, how can I lose my keys? I always put them in the same place. They're always in the same pocket in my coats. They're always in the same hook when I hang them up at the door. They're always in the same place. But I'd lost my keys. And it was just, I was anxious in my dream because I'd lost them. And I woke up in the morning, and I was kind of frantic. And I was like, what does this mean? Because it seems so real to me. And so I kind of started going through the scriptures about keys. Well, what could this mean? What's the possibility of these keys? And as I searched the scriptures, in fact, there's only two references to keys in the New Testament. Only two. And both of them involve Jesus. Both of them involve Jesus. The first one is Matthew 16, verse 19 and following. If you want to turn there, that'd be great. Matthew 16. They're having a discussion at Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus is asking the disciples, well, who do you think I am? Right? And Peter comes out with his great confession, not his denial, his confession that you're the Son of God. And Jesus says, that's great. God has revealed this to you. And then it goes on in verse 19. He talks about building the church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And then Matthew 16, verse 19, Jesus says this, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. It's this idea that God is giving authority to that church, the disciples that are represented there. He's giving them authority. The other passage talking about keys is Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, where Jesus talks about having and possessing the keys to death and to hell. Right? He's conquered those through his triumphant resurrection. And so he has the authority, but he's giving that authority to us. To us. This idea of loosening and binding, of setting free or holding captive. Holding captive. And many have used these different terminologies, have used this passage in many different ways. But I'm going to suggest two things here this morning as we're talking about doubt and despair. As we're talking about fear and anxieties, things that hold us captive, things that lead us and to derail in our Christian faith, our little Christian trains, as it will. And I'm going to propose that there's two keys that we have. The first key that we have is the gospel. That's the key. That's the ultimate key. That's the key that's been given to every believer, is the gospel message. That's how we've been set free, amen? It's the gospel. It's Jesus Christ, his life and death and resurrection. He is the one who sets us free. Sets us free from our sins, sets us free from our baggage, from our past, sets us free from our weaknesses and our frailties. It's that gospel message. And each and every one of us has been given that key, Jesus says, the key of the gospel. It unlocks us, if you will, to experience freedom, to experience victory in our lives. But Jesus talks about keys to the kingdom of heaven. And so the second key, I believe, talks about the authority that Jesus gives to the church, the body, the organized church, if you will. What that means, what that sets up. Because I believe there's a special authority that the church has. Jesus not only came to bring us life and to reconcile us to God, but he came to set up the church. He came to establish his kingdom. He came to build up his bride. We, the church, are his bride, and he protects us. He is very jealous for us. And so he doesn't want us going willy-nilly, going after things that we shouldn't be going after. And so the church proper, the church that celebrates Christ and promotes the gospel, that is spirit-filled and Bible meditative and practice, this is the church. And the church begins to set the parameters of what it is that we are to pass on through Jesus. And so I believe this is this extra key, if you will, this idea that we can't just kind of go around doing whatever we want. Because Jesus gives the authority to the church to keep, to make sure that the gospel is the true gospel. The gospel message is the true gospel message. That those who claim to be Christians set free by the gospel are in fact Christians who are free by the gospel. We begin to see this. We begin to see that it becomes a bit of an authority in people's lives. And it is there as an encouragement. It is there to keep us on track. That's what the purpose of the church is, to keep us moving forward. This is these keys, I believe. The first one is the gospel that everyone gets. That's the key that unlocks us, sets us free. And it also is the gospel that we are to carry forward. We're to be proclaiming it and promoting it. We are to be exemplifying it and moving forward in it. But the other key is this idea, this church membership, if you will, for lack of a better word, right? This church involvement. Jesus has given the keys to the church to loose and to bind. That's what he's talking about here in Matthew 16, right? It's this idea that I'm going to build my church, and I'm giving you the keys of the gospel, the keys of the church itself. Because those that are within the church are those that are going to be saved. Do we understand that? It's throughout the scriptures. I'm not making this up. They go hand in hand. If we're not part of the bride, if we're not part of the church, we're not going to make it till the end story here. That's how important this is. And I think that's sometimes where fears and doubts, where despair starts to sneak into Christians' lives. Where we veer off that little path, we veer away from camaraderie and encouragement and accountability within the church. We veer away and we begin to doubt God's plans, God's providence, and we begin to doubt God's promises when we veer away from his bride. And we begin to think our own things, and that's where doubts come in. That's where fear starts to lead us. That's where despair comes in, and our little Christian choo-choos, the faith lives that we are to have, derail. And it becomes disastrous to us. And so we have to protect that. We have to make sure that we're always running on the tracks of God's promises and our faith in those promises, the faith that God gives us. I have no idea how far away I am here. I'm not too bad, actually. We're all right. We have to be running on these two tracks of promises and faith. Faith, we're trusting. That's all faith is, right? We're believing in what God has said. That's faith. That's trusting. So one track is faith. I'm trusting. I'm trusting in God. What am I trusting? I'm trusting in his promises. And what are his promises? Well, his promises that he has a plan for me. And his promises are that he's going to provide for me and take care of me. So really, the promises just build up the first two. And we have to have faith in those, that God is going to take care of us. He's going to bring us through, even when we mess up. As Christian and Hopeful did, veering off the path, trying to pick the easier route, God will still welcome us back. God is still releasing the keys and opening the dungeons where we are at in our lives, helping us to conquer fears and doubts, helping to release us from our own bondages at times, or the things that the enemy wants to put on us, or the things that society wants to place upon us. But we have to remember that fear is not from God. Despair is not from God. God is all about hope. He's all about life. And so we have to remember that fear doesn't come from God. Where does fear come from? It comes from doubting God. It comes from the enemy. It comes from the world that wants to bring fear into our lives, that wants to keep us doubting, wants to keep us in despair. Doesn't this go right back to the garden? Did God really say? It's the old enemy that put the doubt right into Adam and Eve's ears. Right away, they doubted, and the train derailed. They forgot God's promises. They forgot to trust in Him. And we are the results of that story. But God hasn't given us fear. Scriptures are clear on that. Romans 8:15. We don't have a spirit of slavery anymore, so that we fall back into fear, Paul says. But we have a spirit of adoption, of sonship, that we are the children of God. These are the promises that we have. These are the promises that we use to fight doubt and despair in our lives, to keep us running on those tracks. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7 says, we don't have the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, of self-control. These are promises that God has given us. The other passage that I would love for you guys to turn to is 2 Corinthians. This is a passage that, it's not always a popular passage, I guess, but it's a passage I always tend to go to. Years and years ago, I read this passage and it just stuck with me. 2 Corinthians chapter, chapter 1, verse 19. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 19. We're talking about keys, we're talking about promises. Beginning of verse 19, Paul writes this. He says, "For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, whom we proclaimed among you, Silvanus and Timothy and I, was not yes and no, but in him it is always yes." Right? "For all the promises of God," all the promises of God, "find their yes in him. That is why it is through him that we utter our amen to God for his glory. And it is God who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us and who has put his seal on us and given us his spirit in our hearts as a guarantee." All the promises of God are a big yes, a big fat yes, because of Jesus. Jesus has claimed victory for us already. He's gotten us a big yes. And the Spirit testifies to that. We sang a little earlier about that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is in us. That's the Spirit. That's a big fat yes. That says God promises us to take care of us, to provide for us, that he has plans for us. This is that big fat yes of it all, that Jesus is that yes. Jesus is that amen. There was one commentary on this passage, and it says this. I just thought it was so interesting. On 2 Corinthians chapter 1, it says, "Think of all the profound questions to which God says yes. Do you love me?" We ask God, do you love me? Right? A sinner, a wretch like me, do you love me? Am I forgiven? Am I forgiven? Am I secure in your love? Is there purpose for my life? Is there life beyond the grave? To all these questions, this commentator says, God answers an everlasting yes. That's the victory. That's the conquering of doubt and despair, of fear itself. Fear, which is so prevalent in our culture, in our society. We have a culture that feeds this in so many different ways. And we forget the promises of God. But they're all yes. They're all amen in Jesus through the gospel message, through the hope that he has. He has given us the keys to the kingdom. He's given us the gospel message. We are to claim that and be free in that. That's the purpose. We've been given power and authority. We've been given keys to loose or to bind, to be free or to be held captive. Too many of us within the church are just like Christian and hopeful. We've got the promises of God tucked away in our little pockets, and we're doing nothing about it. And we're going through our daily lives in doubt and despair and in fear and anxieties, and we don't know. I was actually talking with another pastor this week, and he says, everything's going great, and it's going awesome, and all these things, and he's kind of at the river of life right now, drinking it all in. And he says, but there's a fear in me that the other shoe is going to drop, that something bad's got to happen. And I'm just like, well, where is that coming from? That's not coming from God, right? The devil's wanting you to doubt. He's wanting you to stumble on things. And so we have to claim those keys to release. Maybe it's ourselves. That's the challenge I want to put out. Maybe what is holding us back from living out that gospel life, that victorious life? What is holding us? What fears? What doubts? Maybe even in the midst of despair here this morning. You're not quite sure. Maybe you're like the Elijah, who's just like, that's just not worth it anymore. Right? I just want this to be done. What are we struggling with? What are you struggling with? And yet, how can we challenge you to remember that you have the keys to release not only yourselves, but others? Friends, family, neighbors, just by telling them the gospel. By telling them the grace of God, the promises that are yes through Jesus. As often I do, I had this idea of trying to give you guys keys here this morning. And I'm going to hand out some keys. And while I'm handing these out, we're going to play a video. And that's how we're going to close this morning. It's an amazing song. I've kind of stumbled across it in probably the last month. And I really just want you, as it's being played, just read the words. Just feel the words. Let God speak through the words. Because it's this whole idea that God has released us. The song we actually have it up there. Great. It's called No Longer Slaves. And it's this whole idea that we don't have a spirit of fear. We don't have a spirit of fear of intimidation anymore. God has released us. God has empowered us. We have that same power that raised Jesus from the dead in us. And it wants to set us free. And so I'm going to distribute these keys. And you know what? I'm old enough to realize that certain kids' toys used to have little jagged edges on them. And so I tried to find those little, remember those keys that kids used to suck on? They actually don't really have them anymore, but I did find these. So these are little keys, okay? And on there it's just got Matthew 16:19, where Jesus says, I've given you the keys to the kingdom, okay? I even tried to put a little magnet on the back for you guys. That's how much I love you. Isn't that great? So you can hang this on your fridge, right? And when you got some doubts, when you got some despair, when the devil's just making you a target, just go look at this and maybe read the passage and remember the promises of God. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. The promises are there. We are already children of God. We're just waiting for our mansions to be ready. We need to claim that and live in that victory. Amen? Amen. So we're going to play this video. I'm going to hand out keys. If you want to keep key, maybe just put your hand up. I'm not sure if I've got one for everyone. Me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears have come. How about we say that? I'm no longer slave to sin. I am a child of God. I am no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that you are a good, good Father to us. That you've given us your spirit of power and of love and of self-control. We thank you, Lord, that we do best when we're running on the tracks of faith and promises that are straight and true based upon your words to us, upon that gospel message which frees us and unlocks us and our potential. Lord, I pray that you would be with those who are dealing with doubts and despair, dealing with fears and anxieties. And I pray, Lord, we would claim over these ones your promises to release the captives, that this would be the year of the Jubilee, that they would be free. They would be free and experience nothing but grace and love, nothing but forgiveness, that you would release them, Lord, into your service. Lord, I pray that you would help us to overcome our fears when it comes to sharing and showing what you have done in our lives. Lord, we become the gospel of what you have done in our lives. And I pray, Lord, that you would remove fear. Pray that you would remove being ashamed. Lord, when we speak to our family, our friends, when we speak to our neighbors, Lord, you are moving. You are moving in their hearts already. Lord, particularly as we focus in on the Easter season, people are hungry. They want to know change, transformation, what is real, what is true. People are living in fears, and we have the keys. Conquer our fears by your grace so that we would be able to set others free by your gospel, by the cross, by the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our only hope. Send us into this week with your power, your strength. You've given us the keys. Help us to use them. Use them wisely, to use them boldly. And we pray and ask this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You're dismissed. Have a great week.